Hello, in this episode of Bug Bounty Report Explained, you will learn how try weird stuff and see what happens methodology led the bug hunter Teddy Katz to a critical vulnerability in GitHub. It allowed stealing GitHub API token and other secrets from GitHub Actions using a malicious pull request. The reward for the bug was $25,000. Link to the original report is in the description. Make sure to check out other write-ups on Teddy's blog because those are one of the coolest bugs I have ever seen. But for now, enjoy the video. First, I am going to explain commits, branches, pull requests, and forks in Git. If you are already familiar with these topics, skip this part of the video using chapters feature on YouTube. Git is a system version control. It allows developers to work on the project together simultaneously by synchronizing changes between them. After creating some code, a developer creates a commit. It's a snapshot of the project after his changes. Even if developers start adding more code on top of this, this commit with the project at this exact stage will always stay there and will be able to come back to it. And commits are identified using 40-character hex strings. And sometimes, when you develop a feature, you might want to commit your work at the end of the day, even though the code doesn't work yet. But committing such code may break the program for other users. To avoid that, you may create a separate branch where you develop the feature. In the meantime, the main branch will live its own life. For example, a critical security vulnerability might be fixed there. Now, what happens when you finished developing your feature and you want to merge it into the main branch? You create a pull request. It's a way to notify other developers in the project that the feature is ready to be in the main branch. After the pull request is accepted, the feature gets merged and it's available to other users. But what if you are using your favorite script from GitHub and you notice a bug? You may be the good guy and you don't want to just notify the project that there is an issue, but you are good enough to fix it yourself. And maybe you'd like to push this fix to other users as well. But of course, you don't have access to the main repository because no one knows you. You may then fork the repository. It means copy it to your own GitHub account. You may implement the fix there, and once it's finished, you can create a pull request to the main repository. Importantly, each pull request has a base branch. So when creating a pull request, you tell Git to which branch of the main project you'd like to merge your code into. And here is where our hunter comes in. This is the part of the request that creates a pull request. Base ref name is the parameter which tells Git to which branch you want to merge. The hunter asks himself a question: what would happen if instead of putting the branch name there, he would put a 40-character commit hash instead? It would be a bug, but it's unclear what would be the impact of this. But he didn't have to worry about the potential impact because it didn't even work. The response contained a message: base ref name must be a branch. But you wouldn't be watching this video if it ended like this. Turned out that the check was there when creating a pull request, but there was no validation when editing it. So you could create a valid pull request to the branch and then edit it so that the base ref name is a commit hash. But there is still no impact to this. So it's time to introduce GitHub Actions. It's a way to automate processes on GitHub. You can specify some action, for example, running tests on your code that occurs after a specific event, for example, creating a pull request. The action may also do things like adding labels to issues or deploying your code to a server. And when GitHub runs your code, for example, to run tests, it does that in a sandbox environment in order to be more secure. But some of your actions, like deploying your code to a server, may require some credentials to be accessible from the workflow. That's why in the repository you can define some secrets. Those are of course confidential and not accessible when you clone or fork the repository. By default, one secret is created for each repository, GitHub API token with write access to the repo. And when you create a pull request, repo maintainers may want to run tests on your code to see if it didn't break anything. This triggers the pull request action and the workflow starts. It simulates merging your code with the base branch and running the application. In your fork, you may make some changes to the workflow configuration. In case of the pull request event, your code will be used to run the workflow. This obviously creates a huge risk because you could achieve a remote code execution in many ways. That's why this action doesn't have access to secrets from the repository. There is only GitHub API token, but only with read access to the repo. This can be used to securely run tests on untrusted code. But without the GitHub API token with write access, the workflow will not be able to, for example, add label to the pull request. That's why there is another type of action triggered after a pull request: pull request target. The difference is that when you create a pull request, this action doesn't run your code. It runs the code from the branch to which you want to merge, the code just before your changes. It's usually used to add labels or comments to pull requests. Because the code just before your changes was created by someone with write access to the repo, which means that this code is trusted and secure. That's why this type of workflow will have access to secrets from GitHub repo. Let's now connect all the dots together for an exploit. So first you fork victim repository, which means you copy it to your GitHub account. Then you make some changes that are completely irrelevant at the moment. Then you create a pull request to victim repository to the main branch. This triggers the pull request action that runs your code, but without access to secrets. Next, coming back to your forked repository, you create a malicious commit. You create a workflow that steals GitHub API token and sends it to your server. This workflow is triggered by the pull request target action. And this is an example configuration file with the workflow. Next, you come back to the pull request in victim repository. You edit the base branch of the pull request. But now, instead of putting the branch, you put there a hash of your malicious commit from the previous step. It works because for GitHub, commit for a repo is a commit and doesn't matter if it was in fork or not. So now you have this strange situation where you have the pull request in the victim repository where you make some changes to your own code. But importantly, GitHub doesn't know that. Usually, the base of the pull request is trusted code, so in this case, GitHub treats your malicious commit as trusted. That's why it can trigger the pull request target action using configuration from your malicious commit. Then your code is run with full access to repository secrets. Then you can exfiltrate GitHub API token and other secrets to your server, thus taking over the repository and potentially other services as well. The reward for the bug was $25,000, which was the middle of the range for critical vulnerabilities on GitHub. As for the fix, the base branch of the pull request must actually be a branch now. And that's it. For me, it happened a few times that I identified a strange behavior in the application, but there was no real impact. I'm also interested in your stories of strange bugs with or without the impact. I will be waiting for you in the comments down below. I will start with one of my story first. Anyway, if you enjoyed the video, leave a like and leave a subscription. For now, thank you for watching and goodbye.